I think I will start because I have things to show before we begin consultation, and that way people who come late will just wonder what these things were that we showed first. What is this article in the New York Times, which you may have seen? One of the problems in regenerative medicine is just simplifying it enough that people can get a concept of what regenerative medicine is, whether it's something that's here and now, whether it's something in the near future, distant future, what is the status of this. And so this article in the New York Times has rather simple answers. I don't personally think that these answers are correct, but this is a very prominent person. This is the guy who originally created the pluripotent stem cell that is not of fetal origin. And so what he's saying, people are saying, well, you know, how's it going, so on, was the promise of stem cells overstated. Target diseases are limited. There are about 10, he says, 10 diseases. Parkinson's, retinal, corneal diseases, heart and liver failure, diabetes, only a few more. But maybe that's all. Number of human diseases is enormous. I don't know how many, but just a small portion can be treated by stem cells. Why so few? And then he says, we have more than 200 types of cells in our body. Remember that number, 200, because it sounds reasonably precise, and this guy should know. But I'm going to show you another expert who says the answer is 300. So you'll find that not everybody agrees. And he's saying stem cells only work for disorders that are caused by a disorder of just one cell. As long as it's just one cell that's misbehaving, then you treat it with stem cells, otherwise not. So you would get the idea from this that even if you don't know anything about stem cell medicine, that's fine, because those 10 diseases may not have anything to do with your professional life, and you just keep it categorized over here as something you never have to think about, right? Well, as you know, and some of you may have heard me speak before about the idea of tissue engineering pathology, and so I've given quite a lot of presentations about this. One of the most interesting was a Skype flipped classroom session that I did with the Mount Sinai residents and staff of the Mount Sinai health system in New York City. That was very recent, three weeks ago, and quite popular at their end. But I always felt that from my concept of tissue engineering pathology, there was something missing. I didn't know what it was, but I found it a little bit nebulous and complex the way I was describing it. And then last week I discovered the Human Cell Atlas. And this is a presentation by a young person about your age, I would not imagine. I don't know exactly what age she is, but I would imagine late 20s, early 30s. And she came from Israel, I think, in 2013. 2014, she gave the presentation we're about to see. And she's proposing that this crosses all of the institutes of the NIH. That cells don't know which institute of the NIH they're a part of. They're institute agnostic, and therefore all institutes should support this. And in 2016, the NIH decided to do that as sort of the sequel to the Human Genome Project. So it's a really big deal. So what I'm showing you is an example of a young person who gave a really effective presentation.
Neurons from glial cells like astrocytes and so on. Now, cells are also a key intermediate in between the genotype and the phenotypes that we care about so dearly. So, for example, a genetic variant manifesting in immune dendritic cells could increase the risk of Crohn's disease. Another genetic variant manifesting in skeletal muscle cells could end up in muscular dystrophy and so on.
So notice she doesn't use the word pathology. She has never used that word in her entire professional life, as far as I can tell. But this obviously is, you know, pathology. She's talking about variants in cells that are associated with specific diseases. And so she has a system that's really amazing. You can now analyze thousands of cells a minute for a cost of about 13 cents per cell, which is coming down, and it crosses all organ systems as long as you can get the cells in liquid and get them through a microfluidic device. You can not only determine the genome, but you can determine the lineage, origin, the state of the cell, whether it's activated, what proteins it's making, all sorts of things. And you have the link to this.
Completely obvious.
So
that if we actually want.
And I would point out, she's a much better and more engaging speaker than I am. So if you want to spend your time doing something really valuable, you can watch these two videos. And as good as the 2014 one is, and it was worth millions of dollars in terms of the NIH decision about this, when you watch her 2016 video, you'll be amazed at how much better she's gotten. Every slide is better, and she's smoother, and you know, everything. So it is really cool in terms of what a young person might hope to accomplish. Okay, so.
What type of resident is she? Is medicine resident?
Or no. She is in computational biology. She is not a medical person. She's having an enormous impact on medicine, but she's not a medical person. She often asks that she gets keynote addresses where she points out she's not an expert in the field. Like, you know, the neuroscientists have her come to the neuroscience meeting because it's really big in the brain and, you know, in the retina. She starts out saying, I am not a neuroscientist, I'm not a retinal expert. But to me, this sort of fills in the gap. There was something seriously missing in my concept of tissue engineering pathology before, and now I kind of find that if you put it together with what she's talking about, that we have a sort of complete system. There still are questions about where we are, though. You know, is this something you should all be embarrassed to not know more about? Should you be embarrassed to be here this morning because it's of no relevance to the next 10 years of your professional life? You know, where does it fit in? First of all, what are the terms? So the three terms that you may be familiar with: regenerative medicine, tissue engineering, and cell therapy or cell transplantation. And they're all used in an overlapping fashion. Cell therapy or cell transplantation seems to be becoming more used, and tissue engineering less used, and regenerative medicine has stayed pretty much the same over the last decade or so. So what's the evidence that this is worth your time thinking about? If you could save a million lives a year, would that impress you? I think it probably would. This has the potential to do exactly that. If you think of the field of solid organ transplantation, all organs, currently we are transplanting worldwide 120,000 people a year. And that's less than 10% of the need. So 1.2 million people each year reach end-stage disease with some failing organ. And 90% of them wait for an organ that they never get. And so stem cell created organs, bioengineered organs, there are various other ways of doing it besides stem cells, fetal cells, there's, you know, progenitors for the individual organ systems. But if you put all that together, then you could save a million lives a year, and suddenly you would realize that although you've been very proud of what transplantation has accomplished in the past 50 years, that actually there was a lot that was missing. And so now this is a field that would be 10 times larger in terms of funding, people in it, possibilities, benefit to humankind, so on. It would be a really big deal. And so, sitting here today, you're thinking, well, you know, gee, does it impact me? You know, it doesn't have anything to do with the area of medicine that I'm interested in. And I would argue that it does. It impacts every area of medicine, no matter how obscure your interests are, even if you're the only person in the world who's interested in this tiny little area of medicine that you're interested in, that regenerative medicine presumably will be the hope for the future of almost all human diseases. Is it doing anything right now? Well, with simple tubular organs, it's sort of already here. And this is particularly true of the bladder. The bladder may not be a very interesting organ to you, but it's simple enough that stem cells can make it, and there's not a lot of... It's a little bit lumpy compared to a normal bladder. It may have some squared off edges that you don't think a normal bladder should have, but otherwise, it works perfectly fine. So you can make a bladder, and you can make other simple organs. Those of you who are interested in bone and cartilage will know that it's possible to fill in bone and cartilage defects right now with stem cell generated constructs. And in macular degeneration, there have been some spectacular cures. As that first article from the New York Times said, the first person treated had this miraculous cure of their macular degeneration. The second person, they discovered mutations in the cells that they were going to use. It would have almost certainly produced lethal tumors in the patient. So they didn't go forward. And so this, those of you interested in neoplasia, this will be a more and more common origin of neoplastic disease, that you attempted to replace a failing organ with stem cells, and the stem cells forgot that they were supposed to stop turning over at a certain point, and they sort of went beyond that and produced malignant neoplasm. So I felt that although it's obvious that the pathologist has some role in regenerative medicine, that this huge field, 10 times larger than transplantation when it's fully developed, will need people deciding which organs are safe to put in, which aren't, you know, which cell infusions are safe to give patients, which aren't. So the system that the two videos I provided you describes very fast, very cheap, and I think will be rolled out more and more. The other thing that I'm really quite proud of in this lecture this morning, that's kind of at the time of the USCAP meeting, as far as I can tell, the USCAP had absolutely nothing about this. It's like this information, because it seems like it's basic biology. There haven't been physicians presenting about it thus far. It really hasn't reached medicine. So maybe you're in one of the very few first medical conferences talking about this. So the presumption in Aviv Regev's Human Cell Atlas is that there are approximately 300 main cell types in the human body, not 200, as that other guy said in the New York Times. And in the kidney, there are 20. And so now you have a kind of quantitative way to think about tissue engineering constructs. For instance, if you take the liver, those cells, however number of cell types there are in the liver, are pretty much in parallel. There's no series circuit where you've got a little tube and one thing depends upon another and so on and so on. There's a lot of redundancy in the liver. The liver can regenerate itself and so on. The kidney's entirely different. The kidney's sort of strung up in series. And so you can begin to ask, well, to successfully recreate a kidney with bioengineering protocols, what do you need to do? Do you have to get all 20 cells in there, 20 cell types in there? Do they have to be all in the same sequence as there? We will find out. Almost certainly you don't need all 20 just to have GFR, just to have the blood filtered, right? You don't need to be producing renin, you know, renal erythropoietic factor, lots of other things that the kidney produces. Sort of a separate task, an important task, but so probably it will prove not only in the kidney, but all other organs, that it's really very hard to recreate an organ that's exactly like the native organ. What about creating one better than the native organ? That is also possible. Why should we be limited by what the cell constituents in the native organ are? Like if you're an athlete with a certain size heart, wouldn't you like a bigger, more robust heart that can do all sorts of cool stuff, but in many different settings for different kinds of tasks? That's the first thing. And then, so maybe 300 main types, but then thousands of subtypes. And this has been very well worked out, for instance, in the retina and the brain and so on. So her system that she's talking about that identifies cells so quickly and tells you all these things about them can also identify the subtypes. So here she's talking about driving costs down to 15 cents a cell. And she can do 5,000 cells a second. I mean, this is really, you know, amazing. And it seems to me that there's no question that this is going to impact all of us. But in particular, being selfish, it's kind of gives legitimacy to what I'm trying to do, because you've got all this highly funded work at the NIH that's going to be supporting this cell atlas. Now, for instance, let's take a bioengineered kidney. You're putting cells into a decellularized kidney somehow. You can put them in through the ureter, artery. There are all sorts of ways in which you can introduce the cells, and then you can see what happens to them. Some of them stay in the kidney, some come out the ureter, some come out the vein. This would allow you to quickly identify exactly what has happened, which cells are still in the kidney. And it's better than sampling tissue frequently. Like there are a lot of settings. Many of you would know of the biocide trial that's going on here, pancreatic progenitor cells, they're in a protected capsule. You can't just go in and sample them. That would wreck the whole thing. But you can look at the fluid. So it's probably true that biomarkers and other ways of trying to figure out what's going on are going to become important. So I thought, since I have Aviv Regev's email address, it might be fun to see if I can get her to realize that although she's never used the word pathology, what she's doing has huge impact on us and is, you know, compatible with the idea that there will be a new discipline of tissue engineering pathology, which is going to depend upon knowing what all the normal cells of the body are. I think there are lots of surprises. As she started looking, she finds cells that don't fit any existing category, and she can say, well, obviously these are precursors of these. And so she's making amazing discoveries. So you realize that you're currently off the US map. You're in the only big city in Canada that's off the US map, and you may wonder some days whether anything important happens up here off the edge, right? But it does. So in the regenerative medicine area, we have some of the leaders here, believe it or not. So James Shapiro is the PI on this biocyte trial of encapsulated pancreatic progenitor cells for type 1 diabetes. And so I told you that regenerative medicine, stem cell creation of organs is complicated. So, you know, doublethink from the book 1984, it's the idea of holding two opposing ideas in your mind at the same time and accepting them both, right? Well, that's the kind of thing you almost have to do doublethink, triplethink here when you're thinking about the question of, is regenerative medicine good? Or am I in favor of, you know, regenerative medicine? Because in addition to regenerative medicine being the greatest hope for improvement in human health in the future, there's also regenerative medicine hype, where the media tends to overpromise what can be done in terms of the scale, the time course, the stem cell tourism. And all of you as normal human beings are affected by this. You don't think you are, but all of you have like a favorite celebrity or sports star who you follow the every move of what that person does. And if they go to Mexico or China or something and get a stem cell therapy at some poorly documented clinic and they come back saying it's the best thing ever and they feel fantastic, there's a significant likelihood that you're going to do the same thing. And it's an enormous, so who knows about this? Timothy Caulfield, who is one of the University of Alberta's best and most sought after speakers from the Health Law Institute, is the expert on this idea of celebrity influence on medicine, on your own personal decisions. And he's a bit of a celebrity in his own right. He's done a lot of hanging out with them, so he knows about a lot of celebrity culture kinds of things. I'm just going to show you a few of the articles from his group. There are a very large number, but this is work going on here. Combating unlicensed stem cell interventions. From Kim Kardashian to Dr. Oz. Future relevance of popular culture in our health and health policy, science, celebrities, public engagement. You get the idea. So it's a little bit hard to figure out what you personally think about this. And in fact, it may be hard for you to figure out at the end of my lecture today how happy or sad you are that there was such a lecture, because on the one hand, you found out things, on the other hand, you learned some pretty disturbing stuff, and you would like a simpler world where you could just leave the room and say, yes, I'm totally in favor of stem cell creation of organs. And it's a little bit hard because if you look at measures of intellectual dishonesty, fraud in science, it's greater in this area than any other. And so it's really troubling. The greatest promise is in the area that I am describing, and the greatest fraud. And the greatest potential for harm to human beings. So the biggest problem that the FDA and Health Protection Canada faces is just what I've been telling you about, is these clinics where people go and spend enormous amounts of money on poorly documented stem cell therapies, which may just be saline, or they may actually be stem cells that then create, you know, malignant tumors, calcifications where you don't want them, and so on. So it's a really confusing business. In my area of transplantation and renal medicine, you may be aware that there's a loss of luster that 20 years ago, transplant surgeons described that they walk with a special spring in their step. And in social events, you can tell where the transplant surgeons are because they're the really cool people and so on. And now it's just not that way anymore. And we're thinking that eventually the luster could come back to transplantation and kidney medicine with the advent of regenerative medicine. You know that I talk a lot about Moore's Law and machines getting smarter than we are, machine replacement of human labor. And as a joke, I have posited that in 2045, when machines are as smart as the whole human race, the only people still employed will be renal and transplant pathologists, because this area is so complicated. The machines will figure out everything else except this. But of course, that's a cognitive bias. And you would all have this. Whatever you're really good at, you would believe that's the one thing machines will never be able to do. So the Banff classification, now 25 and a half years old, is the classification of solid organ transplantation. There are many medical standards. It's not particularly laudable to be responsible for a medical standard. Most of them have other competing standards, and they all have people's names associated with them. And like in lymphoma and so on, you're familiar with that. The thing that's remarkable about solid organ transplant pathology classification is there is only one. And the way we've been able to do that is when there is somebody making a lot of noise, complaining about what we do. We brought them in, we've given them a forum, and we made them a part of us. And so we've had to remain flexible this quarter century. I couldn't be the macho guy coming into the room with this feeling that the ideas I came into the room with were going to remain unaltered and everybody would accept them. You have to be willing to change your mind. So we plan that there will be a new classification of tissue engineering pathology. It will also be probably a Banff classification, but it will be something completely new. And you might wonder, what young renal pathologists think of the Banff classification. So, Ben Adam, who's just joined the faculty, talks about it as a sign of an educated transplant pathologist. When you start using these scoring codes, he says it gives the imprimatur that you know what you're doing. So anyway, I just thought you'd find it kind of boring if you got only my view of what this is. So that's his young person view. These are some of the milestones. As you may know, for the first 22 years of the classification, we had no structure whatsoever. We weren't a society, we weren't a company, we're just myself and Lorraine Rackeson, these two people, benign guiding hand for this stuff. And in 2013, we realized that's really not a plan for the future, so we created a nonprofit Swiss foundation, the Banff Foundation for Allograft Pathology. The chair of that can serve for 2 3-year terms. So my second term will be up in 2019, and Michael Nagel will replace me at that time. You'd think something that's 25 years old would be old and tired, and nobody would be interested in it anymore, but interestingly, seem to be more articles every year, and many of these are citation classics. If you look at the best journal in transplantation, the most highly cited articles in that journal are related to the Banff classification. So you can imagine the curves will go up even more when we add tissue engineering pathology. This is a graphic of Michael's describing how the consensus process works. Our meetings have a lot of unstructured time where people just generate consensus and are unlike probably other meetings that you've gone to where it's just didactic presentations. Some of the structure, a lot of names. It's not going to be a test on this, some pictures. And this is the next meeting, which is very soon, March 27th to the 31st. The hardest thing I ever did was to get that meeting accredited. And just this past week, the U of A and the U of T, they now jointly accredit things, and it was a tremendous amount of work. So if you're working on anything difficult and you wonder whether it might succeed, there was a time when Michael and I discussed giving up. So like, this is just too hard. Do we need an accredited meeting? Why don't we just go forward with an unaccredited meeting? But anyway, we succeeded. We got the meeting accredited. So the world is changing rapidly. Probably you do need to know about this. You need to know about scaffolds and how you create bioengineered constructs, and you need to know about organoids. Why do you need to know about organoids? The FDA is going to approve liver organoids in 2019. So if you want to test liver toxicity of agents, you don't need to use animals anymore. You can use these liver organoids, which react the same as human liver tissue, and actually test them on liver organoids. And I think it will, you know, that's a step toward stem cell or you know, bioengineered creation of whole livers and so on. So, you would ask whether Canadians want this. And the survey showed that Canadians are very big on regenerative medicine. So, it's kind of nice to live in a country where that is the case. Okay, I'm going to show you, there's another presentation. You may feel this is a bit too positive. So this is the way the tubules and a regenerative rat kidney look. And kidney is capable of doing a bit of function, but you can see that's very not a very normal tubule, and so there'll be many things to worry about. There are areas here where there should be cells and there aren't. There are, you know, the glomeruli with way too few cells. There are tubules with all these interconnecting pathways within the tubule. Podocytes, which should uniquely be present only on glomerular capillaries and nowhere else, go wandering around in the interstitium here looking for fun. I don't know what they're doing, but so. And Corey Fung, who some of you know, he's a student working with me, he did these drawings. Okay, so that's the end of that presentation. Let me just go to the other one. So you know about the Wild West, right? So Wild West was sort of a period in U.S. history where there weren't a lot of rules. And so in transplantation, there was a similar period. So, and you can make an analogy between the original Wild West period of sort of lawlessness and unsatisfactory conduct in transplantation and try to figure out when the comparable period in regenerative medicine is going to end, how long it should last. So regenerative medicine part two, when will the current Wild West period end? What should we do in the meantime? So the first successful kidney transplant between identical twins occurred in 1954 in Massachusetts General Hospital. This is a painting of that. And you might imagine everything has just gone fantastic since 1954, but actually that's not the case. And in the period between 1954 and 1983, many people asked whether transplantation should continue. The outcomes were rather dismal. A lot of patients died. It just wasn't a great time. So that 29 to 30 year period, I would regard as kind of the Wild West period of transplantation. So are we gonna have to wait 30 years in regenerative medicine from now until things are really working? Well, if you think about Moore's law, you can imagine that things are accelerating so quickly that what took 30 years before might take 3 years now. If you think, for instance, of memory storage and, you know, devices, how rapidly that is escalated. On the other hand, we're in medicine, and Moore's law is kind of muted in medicine. It's muted because of security concerns, regulation, different financial model, different financial rewards. So it's not clear that this is going to be a terribly speedy process. And how will we know when we're there? How will we know when things are sort of okay? It is hard to figure that where you would draw the line in the sand to say, okay, these organs we've been able to create up until now are obviously not satisfactory. We can't even try to put them into patients, and now that we've achieved this new milestone, we should try. So how do you make that decision? So suppose, for instance, which would be pretty easy, I think, you produce kidneys which cannot make renin and renal erythropoietic factor and cannot concentrate the urine. They can filter blood, but they can't concentrate the urine. Because it turns out to be very, very hard. You know, the long loops of Henle that go down to the renal papilla, that's a really hard structure for stem cells to meet. Much easier for them to make shortcuts through the cortex, so the fluid just comes out of the glomerulus and whips out of the kidney without any concentration. Would that lead to lethal polyuria? All the patients would pour all their body water out in 2 to 3 hours and be dead? That was the original idea. 1974, Turow and Boylan wrote this article, very cute title, Acute Renal Success. The reason for oliguria in acute renal failure, he said, is the alternative would be polyuria and all your patients would die. And people believe that for a long time. But now regenerative medicine physicians thinking about this are realizing it's hard enough to get those long loops of Henle that we need to ask whether we could cope with or benefit from a kidney that could do all the other things a kidney does, but cannot concentrate the urine. So we'll be asking many of these questions. But now, what about the problem of the very spectacular abnormalities we're seeing in stem cell-generated organs today? Trying to create a classification today, putting those spectacular abnormalities in. I don't think we need to feel embarrassed about them. You don't need to feel embarrassed that the initial attempts at classification reflect the Wild West character of the field right now, because our existing classification of transplantation pathology includes things which never ever happen anymore. We don't see hyperacute rejection, we don't see perfusion injury, and the outcome of those things are very similar to regenerative medicine attempts now. If you were yourself to set about creating a regenerative medicine organ, let me tell you why it would fail. I mean, maybe you could get all the right cells into the organ you're trying to create and keep the cells alive and so on, and you could infuse endothelial cells to pavement over the blood vessels, but it turns out it's very hard to pavement all the surface of the blood vessels. You'll have a hard time doing more than about 80%. And the remaining blood vessel surfaces that don't have endothelium clot like crazy. So that's the existing problem right now today in 2017. But I think it's a solvable problem. Somebody very soon will figure out how to solve this. But it's very analogous to hyperacute rejection. That this is from the original 1968 article on hyperacute rejection, and shows glomerular capillary thrombosis. I'm sure you guys in the back identify that. And so it's very similar to what happens now. And I wrote a poem about this, which I won't read, but you can readily find it. The other kind of poetic thing about this is that regenerative medicine brings attention to parts of the kidney that people have really become completely bored with. You won't find anybody in your professional life who's really interested in the renal papilla today. It's just not a thing. Papillary necrosis doesn't occur very often. Everybody's interested in the cortex. If you do a biopsy, you want to know how much cortex is there. The poor papilla is sort of the forgotten area, and they're probably in every organ. There are areas like that are forgotten in 2017 because nothing very cool goes on there. But it turns out the papilla is the stem cell niche. That's where the stem cells hang out. So the native kidney progenitor cells are in the renal papilla. So even though this condition of analgesic abuse and papillary necrosis was a big deal in the 60s and 70s and no longer occurs, the papilla is coming back as a part of the human body that you might be interested in, because it is the stem cell niche. And there are things you can do that would cause the stem cell niches to release the stem cells that they have, and so on. So this could be really cool. I'm sort of running out of time, but there's one more thing I wanted to tell you. Some of you may feel sort of cheated if I don't tell you about something really cool technologically that you can do with stem cells that you didn't know before you came into the room. So you know about 3D printing. And you probably thought or heard about 3D printing of organs, but that's the situation. We have a 3D printer over here, and it like prints something that looks like an organ, and then you take this 3D printed organ and you put it in, right? But have you ever thought of something more direct than that? Because with bone and cartilage, you can actually print within the bony or cartilaginous defect that you're trying to fill, and lay down the cells there directly. You don't have to create it over here, put it there. So you have a completely sterile 3D printer that you put within the surgical field and you print the things. So I would argue that is super cool. Now, am I getting any education? I'm talking about this, but am I learning anything? I think that's the important thing. So I went to the Termas meeting with Khalid Ahmed, who some of you know, we gave this eye poster. I don't know if any of you have done an eye poster, but it's really cool. Standard poster is static, right? there's a certain amount of data that can be on the poster, that's it. And poster, there's really no limit. You can have videos, you can have all sorts of things linked to this thing. And when we presented our iPoster, there was somebody waiting for us, and this was Astrid Petrosyan, who's like the world's expert, young expert, your age, on extracellular matrix and regenerative medicine of the kidney. And she wanted to make sure that we knew how very complicated this area is, and that we didn't just stumble into making a classification that assumed simplicity when the world is really very complicated. These are two of her recent articles, are really quite good, and here is a graphic showing, for instance, all the different things related to an extracellular matrix, one of which would interest you, and that is that we don't know that the correct extracellular matrix that will work the best for regenerating kidneys will not be regarded as foreign by the host immune system. So there still may be a kind of muted rejection reaction to the bioengineered organ. That is yet to be worked out. And you may know that my other interest is artificial intelligence, so the more Astrid Petrosyan talked, the more convinced I became that we have to apply AI to this in order to figure out what the optimized protocol would be. So now we have real data complexity that will require artificial intelligence, but the outcome should be very good for patients, and we've come a long way. So it's 9:46. Do you have any questions? Sometime after a lecture like this, it's kind of hard to figure out.
What was responsible for the peak in 2005 in regards to the reference?
I have a humorous answer to that. I don't really know, and I guess I will never really know. But 2005 is the year that I visited Leonard Cohen, and so I figured that was kind of a magical, you know, experience, that three-day weekend, and, you know, in my career it created this huge blip. I don't know. I have no idea, because you're quite right. Otherwise the curve is sort of logical, looks like a normal biological process, except for 2005. So I don't know whether it had to do with that three-day weekend in Montreal. Yes.
An unrelated question. Do you know if the ongoing research would halt aging? Because I think that aging really affects human behavior. If people knew that they were not going to age, they would do so many things differently.
Yeah. Well, that's right. I have a lot of people engaging me in conversations about this. And it surprises you. Like, you take any normal group of human beings, like this one, and you would find, and it's probably true, that somebody in this room believes that the motivation for most of what they do is the fact that they're going to die. And if you remove that, they'd have no motivation for anything that they're doing. They'd be completely at sea. Now, I don't feel that way, but it's remarkable that that's a fairly common feeling, that death gives meaning to life. It's sort of a ridiculous thing. I mean, to me, you can't find meaning any other way than the idea that you're going to die. So the other thing about it, which I think you'd find kind of, you know, amusing, is this idea of older people being infused by younger people's cells. It sounds a bit creepy, and you may wonder if after this conference I'm going to approach some of you, please give me some of your cells to infuse, please. But the literature is conflicting, and particularly cells from young women. There have been some outcomes where people who were transfused from young women's cells have died at a much higher rate than other people. On the other hand, Peter Thiel and a lot of very rich millionaires are all parts of these things where they're periodically getting infused by, you know, young people's cells, and they're, you know, convinced that this is going to make them live for a long time. I think it probably increases the number of stem cells, but it probably increases the possibility of developing, you know, malignant tumors, I think. So compare Peter Thiel, who's getting all these infusions from blood from young people, and me, who's not getting any infusions of blood from young people. He's more likely to die from some scary tumor than I am, I think. And it's sort of hard to tell whether it's benefiting him in any way, but yeah. So, no, I think the whole, I mean, if any of you end up watching the videos from my course on technology and future medicine, I mean, one thing we talk about a lot is when everybody's on permanent vacation and doing, you know, virtual reality, which is better than real reality, can be shared with friends and so on. What will the motivation for life be? You know, what? How, and when you meet a new person, how will you describe yourself? How will you, you know, introduce yourself? What will be the main theme of human life? And of course, that's the sort of, you know, utopian side, right? If things go really well, that's the outcome that we're looking at. You can imagine there are lots of other questions if things go quite poorly, you know. So that's another possibility. But no, I think aging is clearly tied to this. And this cell atlasing will teach us a lot about aging and about cell types. For the first time, we'll really know what the cell types in the normal human body are, how they change in all different sorts of disease, and whatever your area of pathology and medicine, this will impact on your life. And if you didn't know Aviv's name before today, you'll notice it again. It's gonna come up.
Not a revolutionary research that has come along in the last few years was the CRISPR technology, where you can actually target mutations in whatever cells, in vitro, or even in vivo, because there was a recent article published in the big I got that from the BBC, where they actually were able to reverse sickle cell disease.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
No, CRISPR Cas9 will change lots of things. For the first time, we can really edit the genome. But you know, from the U of A point of view, the big thing in the last few days, which is, you know, enormous, and will impact many of you directly, and that is that there has been this odd situation, this cryobiology, which is a legitimate area of science, inquiry, and medicine. There's cryonics, which is a sort of pseudoscience of freezing people when they die with the hope of bringing them back, maybe freeze the whole body or just the head, right? And what I could never figure out, I knew that the two groups don't talk to each other. If you talk to a cryobiology scientist, try to engage them about, you know, cryonics, they'll just walk away. They you know, there's such, it's to them just completely stupid, it makes no sense and so on. But what I couldn't figure out is there are a lot of nanotechnology leading lights, like the big names in nanotech, who are promoting cryonics, talking about it. So in the past few days, they found a way of rewarming tissue with, I think, iron oxide nanoparticles, so that you don't get any problems with, like, cleavage planes or, you know, breakage of cells and that sort of thing. So for the longest time, the The largest organ you could freeze and bring back was the rabbit kidney. That's way smaller than a human being. And you could only do that in about 2/5 or 40% of the cases. And in that 40%, you have no idea why those worked and the other 60 didn't. It was a complete mystery. And the function wasn't perfect, but the rabbit kidney that once it was thought would work. Anything bigger, you've got big clefts and cleavage planes and so on. Now I kind of understand that these nanotech experts knew that they would ultimately succeed with this nanoparticle seeding thing that allows you to freeze and then thaw tissue in a way that it will come back. That they knew that this was ultimately going to succeed, and then in the past few days this has been shown. So this will impact, you know, transplantation. It will mean all these people who are big on, you know, cryonics that we thought are weird and crazy, and you know, there's Ted Williams' head, a lot of famous people were frozen away. But they of course, weren't frozen with these nanoparticles, so it's not going to work for them. But it probably will work in the future. So suddenly the cryobiology people who have this learned behavior of never talking about cryonics ever because it's this unsatisfactory pseudoscience are going to have to come together and start talking to the cryonics people. It is really interesting. It's the most exciting news in the past few
years. That harkens back to people who do not want to age or want to be resuscitated. That's the same concept again. Either that people want to stop the clock, or that after they die, they want to be resuscitated.
Yeah, but you know, it isn't simple. If you think about what has happened to you in the last hour, me speaking to you, I was not an engaging speaker 10 to 15 years ago. There's lots of video evidence of that. Somehow about 2013, I became able to tell a joke in front of a group and they'd actually laugh and stuff. Before that, like I remember I gave a speech once and somebody came up to me afterwards and said, Dr. Solez, I actually didn't know you had any sense of humor at all. This is not evidence. You're a good public speaker, right? And I think a lot of other insights also kicked in around 2013. So I'm not convinced that remaining in your 20s, whatever age you might choose, 27, 28, in all respects, with those insights, the sort of crystallized wisdom that older people get, the new skills that kick in, they're I don't know if you know the name Ella Oppenheimer. She was a pediatric pathologist at Johns Hopkins. She did nothing notable up until age 65, except that when the men went to war, she did all the surgical path. So during the war years, when all the men were out there fighting, she did all the surgical path. But at the age of 65, at Johns Hopkins, her kids were all grown, her husband was dead, and she started getting grants. She did all, she had a very, very productive period between 65 and 83. She was really a live wire. And she survived an assassination attempt. Daria House, from London, Ontario, these two old ladies were on the stage once at the USCAB. They started an argument. Daria put her hands around the other lady's neck. I mean, there was no actual murder on stage. I don't think that's occurred, but that's the most. Yeah, so I think it isn't simple. What should you hope for? Where, what kind of, you know, if you can change these things, how would you change them? So I don't think the answer to that's simple. From my point of view, there's always something to look forward to. Okay, well, I think the time is up. It's 9:59. Thank you.